The human being, in the midst of his life, has to overcome a wide variety of different hurdles or different opponents on our way to success. We see, for instance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Holy Quran. He mentions that the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have to deal, for instance, with the munafiqeen. We see in the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the hurdles and the obstacles of Musa alayhi salam in terms of his dealings with Fir'aun. On the very first level, we have what is known as the external enemies that we have to deal with on a daily basis. On the most basic level, we have to deal with people that necessarily don't live up to the same ideology that we do. And oftentimes, these opponents, they can flip our way on the path to success. Secondly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions another type of enemy. He states in the Holy Quran, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُّبِينٌ. That the shaytan, the whispering of the shaytan, and the fact that oftentimes the human being can get swayed by satanic tendencies, also leading him away from the path toward that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires in his life. Thirdly, in terms of the obstacles or the enemies that the human being perhaps has to face on a day-to-day basis, again mentioned in the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةٌ. That your wealth and your children, they are a means by which we thrive. But sometimes we see that our children, our family members, our spouses, they can potentially be an enemy toward us in terms of us getting closer toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We see, for instance, one of the individuals who was a close comrade, a close companion of Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wa salam, to the extent that he was there to defend the house of Ali ibn Abi Talib and Sayyid al-Zahra, salamullah alayha, when the event of the door takes place, a man by the name of Zubair ibn Awwam. He is one of those few, along with Salman, along with Muqdad, and along with Abu Dhar, and along with those other close companions, who came, shaved their heads according to the commandment of Ali ibn Abi Talib, and was amongst who were the most staunchest of supporters of Ali ibn Abi Talib against the Kharafa, which were done at the
yet we find that he's going after it out wide. He gets swayed by the sound of the law incident. And from reaching a level amongst the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who recognize the rights of Sayyidina Zahra alayhi salatu wa salam, they're honorable people. Those who have their memory etched in history as the heroes and defenders of the household of Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yet we find that due to this tragedy, the fact that he allowed himself to submit to world, to start this obstacle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed in his way, and he was unable to overcome it, we find that the world of Allah eventually tries to wage a war against Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wa salam, that is one of the greatest villains in history in terms of those who oppose the household of the Holy Prophet. And fourthly, in terms of these obstacles that the human being has to cross on a day-to-day basis, is perhaps the greatest and most important obstacle that the human being has to cross. The greatest enemy, according to the narration, أَعْدَى عَدُوَّكْ أَنَّفْتِنَّةٍ بَيْتِنَّةٍ. That the greatest enemy of yours, the greatest obstacle that the human being has to overcome in his life, is the soul just between the two shoulders. The human being, the means of the soul, as we mentioned on a previous night, has the ability to ascend a level far higher than the angels, but at the same time, has the potential to fail miserably and become miniature versions of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan or Yazid ibn Muawiyah. If the human being does not allow the soul to become cultivated, if the human being does not allow his soul to become purified, then potentially he can leave himself, an entire community, or an entire civilization into disaster. We go ahead and we need to pose this question on a day-to-day basis. Has our soul been victorious in terms of its battle with the body? We mentioned yesterday that the human being has generally two dimensions. One of that is his bodily dimension, and the second of that is his spiritual dimension. If the bodily dimension overcomes the spiritual dimension, then the only thing that the human being needs is that which is physical, that which lives for 60, 70 days. But on the flip side, if the human being feeds its spiritual dimension, then you see that that soul of the human being lives far longer than our life in this life. And we go ahead and you see that there are several different symptoms of this, or of these diseases of the soul. But before we take a look at that, let's put it in perspective further. Today, for instance, if we were afflicted with a disease, or we lost a limb, now look at that. Today, for instance, you broke your leg, or you broke your arm. How long would it take you or I to go toward the hospital to make sure that we get this problem fixed? If we have the flu, how long would it take before we decide that we need to go to our doctor and take an antibiotic? 15 minutes, probably. If we lost the limb, we broke our arm, immediately we would get into the car and we would go straight to the hospital. Perhaps for someone who has a, you know, great tolerance for pain, maybe he will wait 1 day, 2 days, and then realize there's no way he can bear this anymore and needs to go and have a surgery or whatever, so on and so forth. You see the human being, in terms of its spiritual nature, we also get diseases. We also, for lack of a better example, lose a limb. For instance, we see that the human being, oftentimes we realize that we have a spiritual disease. For instance, for example, that there's an individual in the congregation who, when they were 20 years old, they realize that they have an anger problem. They take out their anger on everyone. They used to take it out on their teachers, they used to take it out on their parents. Then when they got married, they used to take it out on their wives. And then when they had children, they began to take it out on their children. Their entire life, everyone has been telling them, if you have a problem with anger, I'm dealing with it. How long, as you mentioned, would it take once you realize that you have a, you know, physical disease, to go to the hospital and fix the problem? Moments before you realize that there's no way to get out of this if I don't face it up front.
But we see that we are ourselves, we have the problem of anger, we have the problem of pride, we have the problem of arrogance in the earth. A million spiritual problems with our hearts and with our souls. Many of us fail to clean and solve those diseases. Find a cure, find a means to purify ourselves. But this is the problem. And we see that the human being, unfortunately, because of the great villain that we have created within us, again, according to the narration of Abigail Adouan, and that's what they keep on saying, the greatest enemy, the greatest villain, the greatest obstacle of the human being is our soul just between us. We see that through this soul, and by means of this enemy, we allow it to overcome ourselves, and we begin to present excuses toward ourselves to make sure that we never have to cure these diseases. For instance, if you go to the hospital, and the doctor, again, he tells you, for instance, you have high cholesterol. There's going to be one group of people who immediately are going to take heed of this and think that, you know what, I need to start eating better, I need to start exercising, and so on and so forth. But then there's always going to be another group of people, and maybe even amongst them, who if we go to the doctor, or the doctor tells you, or the doctor comes and tells me, you have high cholesterol, what am I going to tell him? No, I don't. What are you talking about? The doctor, they don't know what you're talking about. And we go and begin to make excuses to make ourselves look good so that we don't have to face the reality of the situation that we didn't. Similarly, we used to be human beings. We often do this in terms of our spiritual aspect. For instance, you realize that you have this spiritual disease. You realize that you have a problem with arrogance. You realize that you have the problem of pride. You realize you have the issues of ego and so on and so forth. But what happens? You begin to defend yourself, or you begin to please yourself by saying, you know what? But I'm better than my brother. Because I haven't come to anything. This guy in the mosque, I come to the mosque every day, tomorrow, and this guy only comes on the day of Ashura. You begin to present excuses by trying to demonstrate yourself as better than everyone around you, and you only do it to yourself. This in itself is a problem. This in itself is a symptom of the disease itself. We go ahead and we take a look at another example. We see, for instance, another group of people will come forth and they will say, but you know what? This action that I've been told is haram, will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really punish me for it? He's merciful. He's not that bad. Why do we always give the picture that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wrathful? And so on and so forth. We come up and we try to convince ourselves that the action that we are performing, the moment that we are living in, listening to this, or watching this, or eating this, or doing this, it's not haram because, or even if it's haram, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful. And we begin to become over-reliant on the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is dangerous. This is extremely dangerous. As we mentioned yesterday, the human being has to live in this state between hope and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and also the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Someone cannot say that, you know what, I come. I love Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wa salam. Yes, we all love Ali ibn Abi Talib. But those who truly love Ali ibn Abi Talib, they walk in the footsteps of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wa salam, the same man who would be in the middle of the night raising his hand, 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 his we realize that again, number two, we have another symptom of this spiritual disease within ourselves. A third symptom that oftentimes we see within ourselves is the fact that we become over-reliant on the shafa'ah of Muhammadin wa Ahmad. Allah took out of the that, you know what? Even if I do this, I mean, you know, this prayer. Imam is the same prayer. I cry for Imam is the same in my one tear. It waters down and extinguishes the fires of hearts and our issues. But of course, there are people who are sticking to the over reliance on the Shafa'a of Ahlul Bayt, Allah puts it out to itself, is not what Ahlul Bayt told us. In fact, we come forth and we see that the performance of some actions of a human being, of an individual who used to be a mu'min, can remove him from the guardianship, from the wilayah of Ahlul Bayt, according to Ahmad. fact, in our nation states that, oh, our Shia, the Mahmoud of the Lord, that is the exact words the Imam says, oh, my Shia, that no doubt we will take care of you, and no doubt you will receive our Shafa'ah, but that doesn't mean that you won't have to suffer those hundreds of thousands of years in the fires of hell before you see that Shia. According to our nation states, that those who receive our Shafa'ah, first they will have to go spend 300 times of years cleansing themselves of all of the actions that they perform. Chef Jasmine Christopher in his book, he begins to write a little bit of a dialogue to himself, to his soul, in a book known as The Fast and Christopher. And he makes this point that every day, that he puts it out to himself, that he's often been over relying upon, but now he's realizing that maybe that's not a good idea. He says that when I'm standing in the middle, standing in the middle of the desert, in the middle of the summer, for those of you who have been for time to Seattle, you know, during the days of the summer, for instance, you know exactly how intense the heat is. He says, for 5 to 10 minutes, I can barely deal with the intensity of the sun, let alone the punishment that wants to come out of the moon. But we just come forth and we just see ourselves over relying on the Shafa'ah, without the great time of the Salah to the Salah. And a fourth symptom that often we find that could potentially lead to the spiritual disease or the spiritual diseases that the human being could potentially encounter is the fact that we begin to listen to our own opinions as opposed to the opinions found within the whole of the law and within the prophetic teachings of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We begin to try to rationalize what they say so it fits our worldview. We begin to rationalize what they say so it fits our perspective on life. The moment we try to do these type of things again, we realize that these are all signs of a much greater disease than our hearts, than our souls have been protected. For our discussion today, we need to pose it in several different cases. The first thing is exactly what is the grievous sin. Secondly, what is the harm in not perfecting or not cleansing or not purifying our soul? And thirdly, what are the means for the purification of the soul? Question number one. What exactly is the sin? According to theologians, they come forth and they say, but the soul is the true nature, the essence of the human being. What exactly is the essence? It's the I, it's the me behind what I talk. For instance, if I came up to any one of you and I said, or to present a better example, if I went to your house and I told you, is this your house? I would say, is this house you? Absolutely not. This house is something that I own. It's my property. Similarly, if you lost your limb, or if you lost your arm, or if you lost your leg, or so on and so forth, would you state that I don't exist anymore? No. You would state a part of my physical body doesn't exist. You might have broken your arm. You might have broken your leg. That doesn't mean that you, in your essential nature, don't exist. We come forth and we see that you would never describe yourself as my hand is me, my face is me, my eyes are me. No. You would state that me, in terms of the combination of my feelings, the way that I express myself, is me. No one could explain yourself, no one could explain ourselves without using any sort of metaphysical language. Because the human being is unable to understand something that is not physical. So again, to bring it back into a perspective, theologians say that the human being, the human soul, is the true nature of oneself.
something that not necessarily you and I can explain. You just think that we are, I am I. How can I explain it to me? It becomes something very challenging. The human soul is that which lives behind your body. The human soul or the spiritual nature of the human being is a different dimension. And it's taken a different dynamic than the physical property of the world. After we pass away, our bodies, they go into the grave, but the soul is that which continues to live on. Because that is your true nature, not limited towards physical, bodily, corporeal realm, but real. A second group of theologians, they come forth and they state that the human soul is a combination of one's feelings. But the fact that you feel emotional is not a product of your physical body. When you hear the tragedy of Imam al-Husayn, Ali Salatu was Salam, his family members, his women, his children, and so on and so forth, it's not your physical body that grieves. Rather, it's your spiritual nature that is attached to Imam al-Husayn, Ali Salatu was Salam, which invokes your physical body to release tears, but in reality, the grief, that state of mourning, is that which is real. Similarly, when you encounter a moment of happiness, your physical body might enjoy that moment of happiness. You get goosebumps, your hairs on your body raise, whatever the situation, but in reality, it's that which is within you that has truly encountered that moment of joy or that moment of happiness. Just again, to put it in a very simple definition, the human soul is that internal nature, that spiritual nature that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the human being. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, wa nafsin wa ma sawwa fa alhamala futuraha wa taqwa. We have created and we have fashioned the human being with the soul. And then we have inspired the soul to reach heights of goodness, taqwa, but it also has the potential to fall into a person itself. In the same way, for instance, that the human being has the ability to reach great physical heights. If someone goes to the gym every single day, and they spend 2.5 hours, and they only eat, you know, lettuce and protein, eventually, after some years, after some months, they're going to reach a physical peak in terms of their physical body. But if someone on the flip side doesn't care, and every day they eat, you know, biryani, every day they eat oil, every day they eat, you know, white bread, for instance, and every day they conclude their meal with ice cream, and they conclude with prawn, and they smoke a cigarette afterwards, eventually they're going to see that their body is going to decline a lot faster than the one who just becomes relaxed. Now, the soul also has potential to either be extremely successful or to either fall into a lack of success. But the means for the soul to reach great heights or to fall great heights is far greater. The human soul does not tame itself, it does not perfect itself. If we do not allow our essential nature to become perfected, then potentially we can fall into a mixture, oppressing itself to the extent that we become manifestations, we become reflections of Omar al-Husayn and the other enemies of Omar al-Husayn. But on the flip side, if we mold ourselves and if we train ourselves, we can reach the heights of an individual like Habib ibn Mawahir al-Asad. Let me put it again with an example. Habib ibn Mawahir al-Asad, this great companion of Imam al-Husayn, alayhi salatu wasalam, which I will talk about more in detail tomorrow night. His name again, Habib ibn Mawahir al-Asad. When you enter into the shrine of Imam al-Husayn, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa rahma wa iyyakum bi ziyarati al-Husayn fi dunya wa shafa'atihi fi al-akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all grant us the ziyarat of Imam al-Husayn on the day of the Arba'een, inshallah. Here, we see that when you enter into the shrine of Imam al-Husayn, Habib ibn Mawahir has reached such a great status that when you enter into the shrine, the first blessed body that you have to send your salutations upon is Habib ibn Mawahir. And when you're exiting the shrine of Imam al-Husayn, the last person that you have to send your salam upon is Habib ibn Mawahir. What is Habib ibn Mawahir? Habib ibn Mawahir, Asad ibn Mawahir.
on the flip side with the eyes. A man that would have heard the lie, if it was not him, and I said, what's new? I'm the prophet. And I said, the prophet is very strong. The prophet is very strong. One of them is the awliya, is the way of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I believe it in the Lord. It is great now. We take Shabbat of him. We send our salutations to him. We ask him to be the door before we enter into the shrine of Allah. So that's not the time. When it looks like that from the right of time, comes from the same time, who comes from the same side, who comes from the same family, yet maybe is the greatest villain in history, but he is the one who slays the 6 months. What's that about? One of them affected his soul. One of them cleansed himself of the disease that potentially we should have entered, but from the Rabbi Khan allowed himself to fall and fall and fall into the midst of darkness and ignorance until he becomes Islam, the son of Allah. So, the Rabbi Khan is the question number one. It's the internal nature of the human being which has the potential, which has the ability to become receptive to that which Allah is the kind of. Question number two. What happens if we don't care for ourselves? As you mentioned, potentially we can follow in the footsteps of Hamlab and Khan. We come forth and we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave his gifts, one of the one of the law, and the other one of the Futura, and the other one of the Yahan, and the Kaha. What are the Ha, Amen? The Sahih. And the one who falls into misery, the one who falls into treachery, is the one who fails to care for himself. If we take a look, for instance, at the example of Saddam. Saddam, according to some Western reports, after the invasion and after the fall of Saddam in Iraq, we see that the authorities, the allies, the United States, the supporters, and so on and so forth, when they entered into Iraq, they began to gather files of crimes of Saddam Hussein. They state that we, just in terms of files, we were able combined, we were able to gather together 5,000 kilos, which is 11,000 pounds of paperwork to speak about the crimes committed as a felony. Just paper, just files. How many families does it destroy? How many communities did it destroy? How many civilizations did it destroy? What was the case that we saw? You see what the human being. Physical body doesn't care for itself. Like, if you go back again to this example, the doctor comes and tells you you have high cholesterol. But if we continue to go on our way, eating the oily food and eating that which is healthy, and not exercising and not taking care of ourselves and so on and so forth, who is it going to affect? Is it going to affect that individual and that individual only? That person is going to have difficulty in terms of his health in the future. It could potentially lead to a genocide. It could potentially lead to the destruction of a nation. It could potentially lead to the destruction of the world if one individual is unable to care for the truth, which is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, what about the father? Not the son. We should constantly be in the state, constantly be in the state of fighting this battle to make sure that the soul never overcomes or the diseases of the soul never overcome the heart and allow us to fall or make a misstep, which could potentially lead us toward transgressing the boundaries of Allah's animal. And question number three. Question number three is exactly how are we to become amongst those who perfect or to purify these things. We see there are three different steps that we want to make mention of. Step number one, that the human being has to constantly be overlooking himself and
being aware of his surroundings and walk in a state of depression. We are told, for instance, in classical Islamic teachings, to have what is known as husnul dhann, to always keep a good opinion of those around us. If someone, for instance, they never come to the masjid, we should always give an excuse and say, you know what, they don't come to the masjid here, but maybe they go to another one. If someone only comes on the day of Ashura, you just think, you know what? He probably goes to the mosque a lot more than I do, but I just don't see him necessarily over here. If someone comes into the masjid, or someone comes into your house, and you smell, for instance, the breath of alcohol coming, like the common example that is given by the ulama, but they immediately jump to the conclusion that, no, this is not alcohol, it's breath, but rather, you know, maybe he had some salad dressing that has this type of fragrance. Always give the benefit of the doubt to those around you. Keep the sun down. Give some of the excuses to what you're believing, brother, according to the hadith from the Bible. When it comes to the sun down, that's one thing. We always have to keep a good opinion of those who are around us. When it comes to our own self, we can never keep the sun down. We should always have, for lack of a better explanation, a bad opinion of ourselves. In other words, when you come to the masjid, when you praise Salah, and when you weep for God and forsake, and when you fast in the holy month of Ramadan, and when you perform acts that are mustahab, don't ever think that what you're doing is enough. Rather, always think what you're doing is not enough. And when you see yourself always thinking that you are doing enough, it's the problem. It's the disease of the soul that the human being needs to overcome. For instance, we often come forth and we see that, you know what, someone might say to speak to themselves, but you know what, this recitation of the Holy Quran, it's not necessarily amongst the fulu'ud deen. If I recite the whole of Quran today, am I committing a sin? Am I doing something that is not a good deed? Yes, you're not doing something that is preferable. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always wants you to reflect on the Quran, recite the Quran. I said, I was in the body of the Quran, I'm not believing, I'm following. I said, other people nodding their heads. The problem is that we think to ourselves, you know what? I don't have to recite the Quran today because Quran is not watching. Someone thinks, you know what? I don't have to perform for half a day. So I can make some watching. I'll perform it, you know, when I become old. I'll perform it, you know, when I go for Hajj. I'll perform it during the holy month of Ramadan. So that's a day tonight is not watching. I don't need to perform for half a day. Because we begin to believe that we ourselves don't need these actions. This particular step that we take, or these ideas that come into our mind, are the product of a soul which has not been cleansed. Every moment that we feel that we shouldn't do something, we need to make our best effort to perform that action, especially this action, which is mustahab, an action which has been praised by the Prophet. The moment that in your heart you see that, you know what, I don't have to recite for that today, I'll recite it tomorrow morning. That moment that thought comes into your mind, go against the Prophet. The moment that you say, you know what, I don't need to perform for that today, it's not logic. Make every effort that night to wake up before. This is a way to fight yourself. This is a way to become victorious in that battle. But that's not what happened. That the one who is victorious is the one who is purified. Step number one, in terms of purifying the soul, is to make sure that we're walking on the path and to always be in the state of compassion, to understand our surroundings. One day, the Sahib Dahlun, he comes to Harun al-Rashid. He comes to Harun al-Rashid and he says, oh, Harun, let me ask you a question. He says, if you were stranded in the middle of the desert, would you give me half of your... Excuse me, if you were stranded in the middle of the desert and you needed a cup of water, you would die of thirst. And you needed a cup of water, would you give me half of your kingdom? He said, obviously, of course I would. A cup of water, it's not in the middle of the desert, I'm going to die, I'm going to take the water. So absolutely, I'd give it to you. He goes, fine. Cool. He said, then I have another question for you. He said, what is it, by the way? He says that if you were stranded in the middle of that desert, and you had drunk that water, and then after a couple of hours, you needed to remove the water from your body. You needed to. You were not. And you were unable to. But I had a medicine that would give you the ability to do so. Would you give me the other half of your kingdom? All of your wealth for your health. But the Holy Ghost has come to you and makes sure you remember to live your life according to these examples, according to the story that I've just given you. Because life is simple, very simple. You give up your entire life for a cup of water and to remove that water from your body. Keep in mind that to not allow everything to enter into your heart, everything to enter into your soul, which could potentially need it. Step number one, to always make sure that you start a state of course. Number two, to constantly be in the state of humbling ourselves in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, I'm even a being, I'm the God of the Siraj wa Salaam. It's the leader of the Islamic world. Is a leader of upwards of 50 countries, contemporary world as we know it today. Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ayyub Raja al-Salam, the victor of Badr, and of Omar, and of Khandaq, and of Haydar, and of Sahih, and of Sistine, and of Yemen, and of Nahrawan. Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ayyub Raja al-Salam, which is the healthy wisdom of that. During this time, the Kufan, and the Quran, and the last of the Kufan, called God, the Quran, Servant in the Messenger, every one of us to be a servant to the Lord of the Savior in these days and during these nights. We humble ourselves, and these are means for our souls to become purified, to become perfected, and to become elevated to that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thirdly, in terms of the first step, and finally, and arguably most importantly, in order for the human being to walk on this path, to making sure that he understands himself, and to making sure that he is able to perfect his heart and to perfect his soul, he needs to make every single effort to perform a'mal in the way that they have been built by the Messenger of Allah to the Quran and the Sunnah. Today, we have this movement taking place in many parts of the world, within our communities, the followers of Ahlul Bayt. In the name, we mentioned the previous night, of spirituality. They go and we try to find a spiritual teacher, for instance. Or we go and we try to enter into different theological circles, like Sufism and the like, because we feel that these are paths to take us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In reality, we find that every single Sufi tariqa, with the exception of one, they go to the teachings of Ali ibn Abi. They go through the teachings of Imam Sajjad. They read and they reflect and they contemplate the du'as and supplications of the Sufi Sajjad. In one of the du'as that we recite in the Bible, Imam, or one of the du'as that we recite in the Bible, ويستيقظ أسراب عليك أي حد وعلى من المرشد. The word مرشد is a title given to work as spiritual teacher. We don't need spiritual teachers because we have our teacher if you want to attain this great height, this means to feel sad of soul, that's the way it's going to happen. We go to our time to recite the Dharma from the Hadith that we've said, recite the theology of Mingya, recite the Dua for Monday, the Dua for Tuesday, the Dua for Wednesday. These Duas narrated to us by the Imam for the other day, Ali Masih Salaam himself, are far better than anything else that we can find in the literature, you know, the Islamic literature, or even the secular literature. If we truly want to become amongst those who have our souls perfected, then the only pure way to reach that goal is by taking the path Muhammad. In this subject, there was once a Snob. He was a student in the Islamic seminary of the Holy City of Natchez. He was taking a class on Ilmul Akhlaq. This is a class on ethics. He did a class on, you know, for lack of a better word again, you know, spirituality. It's a very popular word. He felt that if he takes this class, he'll all of a sudden be able to, you know, do truly remarkable things. Like he said, he goes to work as a teacher. 2 years he studied under his teacher. But what does he find? He finds that he himself has not made any accomplishments in his life. In fact, you can see that he's more focused on his priorities. He can barely wake up for Salat al-Fajr. You know, he doesn't do any Muslim acts that's truly remarkable. He doesn't actually get better in the midst of these 2 years. So he decides to one day go to work as a teacher and tell him, you know, that I've been taking your class for 2 years. What am I doing wrong that I'm not able to apply what you've been taught me? Where, you know, what was your plan? So, that morning he makes the intention that he's going to go to work with his teacher and tell him. So he goes to the class concludes. He goes to his teacher from the church and asks him to come. He says, I've been studying with you for 2 years, but I've not been able to attain any sort of spiritual development. I've not been able to do anything. I don't feel myself getting better. I don't feel myself becoming a better person. The teacher says, number one, boy. He says, I studied for 2 years. You don't know who I am? He says, no. I don't really know students who actually did the steps to their time. But the fact that you've come to me finally after 2 years, I won't forget you. So he says, you know, what am I supposed to do? What am I going to do? Tell me, explain to me. What is the path that I'm taking? He says, let me think about it and come back to me tomorrow. I've done a little bit of research about you. And I understand that in this classroom, that you have some family members who also come to work this particular lesson. He says, not really, I have a second cousin, I have a third cousin, I have this big uncle, this, that, whatever. He says, what is your relationship with them? The teacher asks the student, what is your relationship with them? He says, I say, so I'm not even body compared to your cousins. He says, all of your cousins. Over your studies. You don't need anything until you actually make an effort to the steps of the Quran, bring in relations between the Islamic religions. What is he going to do? He says, go to work done. And do something to work done, and you will find your life will change. He starts to think, I realize I should probably be less than my teacher. Something so simple. Something so practical. Oftentimes we want to, you know, be able to fly in the skies and want to be able to reach the moon, and we think that this is what, you know, having data told us, you know, it comes to that. According to that, those things which are practical follow me. One of the gives the advice. He says that if you want to attain these great heights of understanding, the blackness of Allah, so you take them as number one. Take the Risala Amaliyah, the Islamic law book of your marja, and begin to study it. And number two, read the Fatih of Jinnah. Read the Du'as of Imam Ibn Abidin. That's it. And then you'll be able to see changes. please don't get out there. I left the class. And where we kept our shoes before we entered into the restroom, I began to take the shoes of my family members, my second cousin, my third cousin, my uncle, and my nephew, or whatever, and I just placed it in front of them. I said, Assalamu alaikum, have a nice day. Because the moment that I humbled myself in front of them, I began to see that my life began to change. I began to see that my effort, that my ma'rifah, that my focus was their entire existence. If we want to become a Muslim, we can perfect ourselves, we can perfect ourselves, reach these great heights. We all we have to do is follow the most basic etiquette taught toward us, to have faith, as Muslim Salatul. Brothers and sisters, and amongst those individuals who allowed themselves to overcome those spiritual diseases that was part of his soul, within one moment and transcended the heavens, and transcended history, was a man by the name of Khalid ibn Yazid. This man, Khalid ibn Yazid, who on one moment, millions of people would be stating him amongst those who received the La'an on the day of Ashura, on the day of Arafat, on the day of Arafat, on the day of Arafat, on the day of Eid, on the day of Eid, on the day of the nice and the little Babel. He was one of those who would condemn the whole thing. Because he was that individual solely responsible for bringing the money to the Prophet of the Islam. Because of that means for him to perfect his heart, the means for him to perfect his soul. That decision that he made, today we have millions of people who go and he stayed as Salaamu Alaikum, Ya Salaam Alaikum, Salaamu Alaikum, Ya Salaam Alaikum, Ya Salaamu Alaikum, Ya Salaamu Alaikum, Ya Salaamu Alaikum, Ya Salaamu heroes in history, for the decision that he made, and all began with that which took place. He states the words, in our next generation, children are still upset between the gardens of paradise and the gardens of hell. You see, but that which brought the Khalid ibn Yazid to the command of Hussein, alayhi salatu wasalam, who had several different stages at several different steps. It wasn't immediately the fact on the day of Ashura that he saw Imam Hussein that led him to it. But rather, when we go ahead and we take a look at the Mabarak of literature, we come forth and we see that there are several different occasions which spark what of the Qur'ani to allow him to come toward the camp of Imam Hussein and accept it. Firstly, it is said that Imam Hussein, alayhi salam, he leaves Medina to go to Mecca. And Mecca, of course, on a journey to a pizza to go and respond toward the call of Islam. As he's on his way toward Kufa, he is intercepted by Hur and his army in a small town known as Ash-Shafi. In this particular town, Hur ibn Yazid of Yari, he comes to where the man of Hussein, and he says, Oh, Abu Abdullah, it is my responsibility to not lead you toward Kufa. I have to lead you on my way. But you have the option, and your option is to come with me, and we go to Damascus, and we give the bay'ah to Yazid ibn Umar. He said, absolutely. And you can do whatever you want, but you're not going to stop me from doing it. It is said that at this moment, Khalid ibn Yazid of Yari, again he tries to advise about it for Satan, alayhi salatu wasalam, to not repel, but if he says, Ya Wada Abdullah, if you do not give your bay'ah to Yazid ibn Muawiyah, we are going to have to kill you. At this moment, Imam Hussein, alayhi salatu wasalam, he utters a phrase to Khalid ibn Yazid al-Ra'id that begins the first means to change his heart, to change his soul, and bring him closer to us. What does the Imam say? He says this phrase. He says, Sa'alat ta'ummuki ya Rasulullah. He says, May your mother be with you. May your mother be with you. Let me put this in perspective. The Imam Hussein, alayhi salatu wasalam, is the son of Rasulullah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We did not send you, O Rasulullah, except to be a mercy to that man. We never expect the Prophet to say, alayhi salatu wa salam, to use the type of language. But the mother grieve over you is an insult. To say that look at the type of action you're performing, even your mother would be embarrassed if we spoke like this to one community member. Imagine the reaction. Your people in prayers, and I will leave my people in prayers. At this moment, again, Rabbi Hussein, alayhi salam, he's trying to guide him, but using this type of language. Of course, he says, oh Allah, Allah, you are the son of Rasulullah. How can I lead prayers when you're leading prayers? And he comes, and he orders his entire army to go and pray, salatul jama'ah, the salatul jama'ah. And number three, and perhaps most incredibly, on that day itself, the heart of it is even behind these truths. He comes and he intercepts the Imam of Hussein, of course, at this land known as Shaykh. The heart of it is even behind his army, his horses, everyone who is around, they make this journey of an extremely exhausted, but they say, I am. When the Imam of Hussein, Ali Salaf, recognizes and realizes that the army is far, doesn't have any water to drink for themselves, and has no water to cool down their horses. Prophet Hussein, alayhi salatu wasalam, along with other Fadl al-Abbas, they go toward Har, and they begin to take the vessels of water and feed it toward the enemy. To the extent that one of those in the army of Har says, I remember the beautiful face of Hussein coming toward me. He took the vessel, and he poured it into his own hands, and from his hands he gave it to my hands. This is Hussein, the son of Rasulullah. This is Hussein, the divine representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. On the day of Ashura, he is looking at the camp of the Imam Hussein, alayhi salatu wa salam. It is said that as he's looking at them, he's trembling. One of the companions come come toward him, and they say, oh, 4 years of war, give it to your horse, take care of your horse, and drink for yourself. Soon the moment is going to come when the heads are going to be rolling on these plains of the Quran. And he said that at this moment, he looks at his horse, he looks at that companion, and he looks at the camp of the man of Hussein, alayhi salatu wa salam, and he begins to tremble, perhaps wondering what he's doing with the water in his hand when the children of Hussein don't have any water. Perhaps he's wondering what he's doing giving water to his horse when Hussein himself has no water. It is said that at this moment his companion looks toward him and says, oh, if they were to ask me who was the most courageous of the men of Kufa, I would have sworn by God it was you. Why are you trembling at this moment? He utters those words, Inni ara nafsi bayna jannati wa nar. For at this moment I see myself between the fires of hell and the gardens of paradise, and by God I will not choose anything over paradise. It is said that at this moment, he climbs on top of the horse, or according to another narration, he walks by holding the reins of the horse. He goes and closer toward Imam and Hussein, alayhi salam. He puts his hand on top of his head, and he lowers his spear, and he lowers his sword, and he wears his shield upside down, and he begins to walk closer and closer toward Imam and Hussein. But my brothers and sisters, tonight is a night for us. Tonight is a night where we purify our hearts and where we purify our souls
tonight, and not where we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. For we were not amongst those who brought the women and the children of Hussein to Karbala. But oh Allah, we are sinners, so let us bless him with Hussein, also forgive us. It is said that Qurb ibn Yazid al-Riyah, slowly by slowly, is approaching the camp of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. It is said that some of the companions of Imam Hussein at this moment will come out of their tents and they begin to walk closer and closer toward him. Imam Hussein says, oh my companions, step back, leave this one to me. It is said that Qurb ibn Yazid al-Riyah, he walks closer and closer until he stands in front of Imam Hussein. Imam Hussein comes out of the tent and he says, men and Qurb doesn't respond. Who are you? Again, he says, men and he doesn't respond. A third time he says, Ya Rajul men and who are you, old man? He says at this moment. He doesn't respond to him by saying his name because he's too embarrassed and his eyes looking down, his hands are on top of his head. He says, Ana Nabi Ja'at min al-tariq. I am the one who has taken you away from your journey. I am the one who is responsible for keeping your women and your children in captive. I am Qurb ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. Hayni min tawba ya Aba Abdullah. Is there some forgiveness for me, O Imam al-Hussein? At this moment, Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam says, O Qurb, yes, there is forgiveness for you as you seek from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, I like from your horse, so I can embrace you, so I can enter you into the camp. It is said that at this moment, Qurb ibn Yazid al-Riyah, he says, oh Aba Abdullah, I'm embarrassed to light from my horse. I'm embarrassed from Zainab. I'm embarrassed from the children. Allow me to become amongst those who are the first of those who are killed in your way. It is said that Imam al-Hussein, in some narration, states that Qurb was the first one who went out. Imam al-Hussein, alayhi salatu wa salam, after salatu wa salam, he allows Qurb ibn Yazid al-Riyah to go and fight. Narrations state that he went out and he fought the enemy and he fought valiantly until he made that call, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah, Imam al-Hussein alayhi salatu wa salam. He rushes toward Qurb like he rushes toward any of the other companions of his. He places the head of Qurb into his lap. And every one of the companions of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salatu wa salam, the last thing that they were able to have the blessing to see was the face of Imam al-Hussein. It is said that at this moment, Qurb says, oh Aba Abdullah, do you forgive me? He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven you. And at this moment, Imam al-Hussein says, and Qurb kama sanatka ummuk, surely you are free in this world and in the next. In the same way that your mother named you at this moment, it is said that Qurb ibn Yazid al-Riyah takes his last glance at the face of Imam al-Hussein, alayhi salatu wa salam, calling out, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. But I'll ask you this one last question, O mu'mineen. I will ask you this one last question, O Sahab al-Zaman. That every one of the companions, they looked at the blessed face of Aba Abdullah before they passed away. When Imam al-Hussein was passing away, he was facing the opposite, and he was sitting on his chest.